The evolutionists routinely claim that the geologic and fossil records support evolution. But let's see what this book of the Earth tells us really happened in the past.
One thing everybody expects an Oregon man to be gray-haired, old.
Look inside you and be strong, and you'll finally see the truth of that a hero lies in you.
How old is the Earth? Well, some say it's millions and millions of years old, but our guest on the show today says it's a lot younger than that.
Yes, Dr. Robert Gentry and his son David, they are physicists from Knoxville, and they say that God left some fingerprints of creation in granite.
Okay.
A lot of the scientific community refutes that.
Also on the show today, we'll go on location with a man named Sean Meek. You know, when you build a highway, you have to sometimes cut through some rock to put the highway in. He says there's evidence of God's creation on that rock.
I believe
that. We'll take a look at that.
I do. I believe that. And in the Just for Fun segment today, we have a sort of a creationist. He builds organs.
Well,
is that right?
He makes organs. I wouldn't call him creationist, but I guess he could be.
All right.
And in the That's Entertainment segment, Summer Pulley will be here to sing for us,
a young
entertainer. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back.
But it's in these foundations of the Earth that we found something very, very exceptional in terms of their creation.
And what was that?
Creation, as opposed to evolution, can finally be proved. God left his own fingerprints in creation, in this Earth, in the granite rocks. And we have some very special people with us here today. They are physicists from Knoxville. Dr. Robert Gentry and his son David are with us today. And we want to thank you both for being with us.
We're happy to be here with you.
Thank you.
Glad to be with you.
Glad
Thank
to be with
you.
Us. What have you discovered that's the solid evidence that the Earth was indeed created?
Well, let's remember that the Earth today is composed of various kinds of rocks. And it's a certain kind of rock that we're going to be talking about that contains this evidence of creation. We're all familiar with the Grand Canyon. The Grand Canyon rocks are rocks that were primarily laid down by the action of water. They're sedimentary rocks. We're all familiar with volcanic rocks coming out of the volcanoes in lava and so forth that we see in various places of the world. But then there are the foundation rocks of the continents. This building tonight, we're not sitting on mud. You've got a good foundation here. And all the continents of this Earth have a foundation, and the foundation rocks are essentially the granites. The granite rocks are seen in Mount Rushmore and El Capitan and Yosemite, Pikes Peak. They're all over the world. Here in Tennessee, you have to drill down in order to actually reach the foundation rocks, the granites. The granites are interesting from the standpoint of geology in that they are the foundation rocks. They're also interesting from the standpoint of the Bible, because in Hebrews 1:10 it says, "And thou, Lord, in the beginning didst form the laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands."
Which are these granites?
So we can identify Job 38. Where wast thou, Lord? Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Several places in the Old Testament identify the foundations of the earth. So it's in these foundations of the earth that we found something very, very exceptional in terms of their creation.
And what was that?
Well, we found the polonium halos in granite.
What's a polonium halo? You lost me already.
Okay. On the cover of the book is a large picture that
right
looks
there.
Like an archery target. Those three rings there represent the decay of three nuclear particles. The alpha particles were ejected from that radioactive center, and they did so in such a short time that the rock had to solidify around that inclusion before the half-life of that polonium-218 expired. And this poses a problem for evolution. How, you ask? How does it pose a problem for evolution?
How, do you ask?
Well, why don't you give the Alka-Seltzer analogy very quickly.
This Alka-Seltzer tablet is a bit of polonium, and this glass of water
is a piece of molten granite. I drop the tablet in, and it begins to fizz. Think of these bubbles as the radiation emitted by that bit of polonium embedded in the granite. This fizz will go away in about 30 seconds, and we'll have nothing left but a slightly tangy glass of water. Now, is there any way we could preserve these bubbles as they are? We could try placing the glass in the freezer. The water, of course, would solidify after a while. That's something similar to what evolutionary theory suggests, that molten rock slowly cools to form granite. But as you've already guessed, freezing this glass of Alka-Seltzer wouldn't do any good. The bubbles will have gone long before the water turns to ice. And that's exactly what would have happened to polonium radiation if the granite had slowly cooled. It would have disappeared long before any radio halos could have been imprinted in the solid rock. If I show you a frozen glass of water with all the fizz of a tablet still intact, like this, you will know that something happened to instantly freeze the water. In this case, we merely froze it instantly in time by a pause of the videotape. Likewise, if we look at a radio halo demonstrated unmistakably to have been produced by a certain kind of polonium, we can know that the granite around it had to be formed instantly.
The scientific community, though, scoffs at this. Why?
Well, the scientific community doesn't accept it. That's true. However, we must remember that for 13 years I was doing this research at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory, publishing papers in the open scientific literature sustaining this evidence. And in 1981, I was called by the state of Arkansas to go and testify for the evidence of creation at the Arkansas Creation Trial. All this information that we're talking about tonight came out in a very public way in my testimony there at the Arkansas trial. Mm-hmm. Evolutionists, world-famed evolutionists, came and were unable to refute this evidence. 1981, the gentleman who testified for the ACLU, trying to disaffirm, so to speak, this evidence, the best he could do during the trial was to say that I had found something that was a very tiny mystery in these granites. And of course, these little halos are, first of all, microscopic. But the fact of the matter is, he wanted to denigrate the idea that something had been found that was of any significance. So he said, it's a very tiny mystery, which he thinks, you know, someday that geologists were going to solve. Well, 14 years down the road, no solution. You see, I've started a new paradigm.
And you have those a standard kids, there. You've got to have a standard to go
and,
by.
Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is, if we cannot trust the Lord to communicate to us in meaningful terms in the here and now, for the common individual, we don't have any anchor. There is no basis for a belief in anything. If today's culture is going to be used to transfer a belief from the biblical definition to something that we think might be true from science, then we're lost at sea without an anchor.
Creation's Tiny Mystery. This is the first book, and then the second one that comes out evidently is going to reach out into the universe and tell us the location of heaven, maybe. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very
appreciate
much.
Appreciate being with
thank
us.
You. Thank you.
Okay.
Now, some of the things that are also found, although quite rare, are things like dinosaur eggs. Now, this is a reproduction of a dinosaur egg. And if you look what happened to it, it got crushed. What we see here is a road cut, the kind of road cut you'd find on major highways throughout the United States. Hi, I'm Sean Meek, Executive Director of Project Creation, a creation education ministry founded in 1992. You know, when we find road cuts like this, what we're looking at is a history of the Earth's past, sort of like pages in a book. They tell us what happened in the past and let us know some of the things that were here before we came along. And in fact, if you look at the sedimentary rock that this consists of, you'll see that this is what covers most of the Earth. Most of the Earth's covered by sedimentary rock, rock laid down by water at some time in the past. And in fact, the sedimentary rock is very good because it also has a lot of fossils. Now, in the creation-evolution controversy, the evolutionists routinely claim that the geologic and fossil records support evolution. But let's see what this book of the Earth tells us really happened in the past. One thing we know about how fossils are created is if fossils are not created quickly, they won't be made at all. In fact, if you look at some of the fossils you can find around Tennessee, such as this little fern. Now here we have a fern that was buried at some time in the past under a great deal of mud. Now, under ordinary circumstances, a fern, if it simply dies, is going to decay very rapidly. And yet if you look closely at this fossil of the fern, you can see great detail in it, showing the this fern was buried very rapidly. So what we know about fossils is if you find rocks filled with fossils, the rocks had to have been made quickly, or they wouldn't have any fossils at all in them. All the things would have decayed very rapidly. Another thing we find when we look at the geologic and fossil record is marine mollusks, such as this. Now, when we look at marine, we find marine mollusks all over the Earth. In fact, 95% of all animal fossils are marine mollusks. Now, this was found in Tennessee, but you can find marine mollusks like this everywhere. Even at the tops of the highest mountains in the world, you will find marine mollusks. Again, telling us that at some time in the past, the Earth was covered with water, which laid down a great deal of sediment, burying animals all over the place, just as the Bible tells us happened during the Great Flood. Another little creature here is a trilobite, a little animal that used to live on the bottom of the ocean. This was found in the middle of Morocco, not exactly where the oceans are. Many trilobites are found all over the United States, including the majority of them in Utah. We see this as we see animals from the bottom of the ocean buried in what are now deserts, showing how things have changed since the time of the Great Flood. One of the things evolutionists like to say is one way they can tell the Earth is old is by dating the rocks. That they can take igneous rocks, such as this piece of lava, and they can date it using a radioisotope test. Well, that's what they did with this piece of lava, the flow that this came out of. They dated it using a potassium-argon test. And the date they came up with for this rock was 2.4 billion years old. Now that might sound very old, except for the fact that this rock was erupted from the volcano in 1801. And for those of you who are skeptics about this, let me tell you that you begin the dating of the rock from when it cools off. So in fact, this rock really is less than 200 years old. Because there is no test that can tell the age of a rock. All the test can do is tell you the proportion of the elements in the rock. In this case, potassium and argon. Potassium is radioactive and turns into argon over a period of time. So when evolutionists do the test on it, what they're doing is finding out what the proportion of potassium and argon is. This rock happened to have had a great deal of argon in it, so by evolutionary standards, it should be very old. But it isn't, because the tests are very inadequate and unreliable. In fact, evolutionists routinely test their rocks and discard many of the dates because they don't fit in with their evolutionary assumptions. Now, some of the things that are also found, although quite rare, are things like dinosaur eggs. Now, this is a reproduction of a dinosaur egg. And if you look what happened to it, it got crushed. Now, an ordinary egg of any sort, dinosaur or any other reptile or creature, left to itself, after it was crushed, it would decay very quickly. And yet this must have been buried very rapidly for it to have maintained its shape so it could become fossilized. Another indication of how rapidly the flood came and how quickly it buried the different items we see around the Earth. So when we look at the real book of the Earth, the strata that we see in front of us, in road cuts and other places, what we see is a record, first of God's creation, of how He made it and how it stayed the same until the time of the Great Flood, and then we see the record of how quickly it was buried and frozen in the rock, waiting for us to come along and look at it and to see the evidence of what God has done.
Do you ever wonder who builds those great big pipe organs in the auditoriums and churches all over? Well, maybe it was the Milnar Organ Company, and Larry Souder went to visit where they build these great big pipe organs in this Souder and Friends Classic.
Mm-hmm.
thing everybody expects an organ man to be gray-haired, old. And when we started in business in 68, imagine how I looked in 68. I was 25, looked 18, had a crisp Yankee accent, and it was a little tough getting started. But I think one of the things that really makes our organ something special are the people that work here. Because each and every one, like myself, have a true feeling for the organ, and we care. And I think that care shows in the product. In tuning an organ, it just takes an average ear, just to practice in hearing not the sound produced, but what's produced between the sound that is created between the two different pipes. You tune with one pipe played against the other, and what is created is a wave or a third sound, and you try to eliminate this wave.
There's extreme satisfaction being able to take raw material, rough wood, and be able to cut it and shape it and glue it together and work on it and come out with an instrument like that. To stand back and to see that you've been able to do that is very satisfying.
It's certainly not the money. You can talk to anybody here, too. It's not the money. It's the love of the work. Once it gets in your system, it's there. This is my life. Probably will always have some hand in it. Organ men don't usually retire. They just die off.
Well, today on the entertainment segment, a young singer by the name of Summer Pulley is here.
Yes, her song is called Heroes.
What you are.
Well, that's Summer Pulley. Good voice, don't you
yeah,
think?
Yeah, beautiful.
She was a runner-up, I believe, on Ted Mack's Amateur Hour. Maybe not the original Amateur Hour, but Ted Mack's Amateur Hour.
Yeah, that's been on for 100,000 years.
This makes
years.
Her probably 45, 50 years old.
I think she's about 18.
And we also learned on the show today what a radio halo is,
yes.
which you'll be writing an essay
yes.
on that later.
Uh-huh.
And we learned about the man who makes organs, and we
yes.
learned about something that's close to you, what a fossil is.
We'll see you next week.
So long.
Fossils.